The next speaker is Martijn Jeroen van der Linden. He is a researcher at the Technical University of Delft, doing research into economics and stuff. He is also one of the members and founders of Stichting Ons Geld, Our Money. I don't know if everyone here knows De Wereld Draait Door, The World Keeps on Turning. It's not the soap series, but it's a Dutch actuality show.
Talk show.
And a week ago, some famous Dutch actors, they launched an initiative called Burger Initiative.
Ons Geld.
Burger Initiative Ons Geld, Citizen Initiative Our Money. They want to have a public discussion about how money is actually created, because people often think that, you know, you have gold at the bank, and when you buy some euros, then you buy in some way some share in the gold. But in reality, it's different, and the Citizen Initiative wants to make that into a discussion. So Martijn is going to talk about it, and please a big welcome for Martijn Jeroen van der Linden.
Yes, thank you for the invitation to speak here. So I will focus today on the Citizens Initiative. And so the topic is really broad. It's about economics, about science, about politics, about arts, and about activism. And I just give one example how we did it to get money creation on the political agenda. I'm a PhD researcher at the TU Delft, and I'm a board member, as said, of Foundation Our Money. And my background is that I studied business administration. I worked in banking and finance. I was a day trader with ING. And since 2010, I'm busy with new economic thinking. So that's green economics, that's degrowth or growth. But more and more, last year, I became interested in the monetary system. How the monetary system works, how money is created, how money is allocated, so the way how we use money. So that's why I founded, together with another guy, Stichting Ons Geld. And what we tried to do the last 3 years to get money creation on the political agenda. So we had quite serious presentation, hold serious talks, had serious conversations with all kind of economists. But we failed. And then half a year ago, we got an email of this group, the theater group, the Verleiders, that they were making a theater show about money and banking. And they used our website and our information and also books of other critical economists to make their show. So we were quite surprised, and we were really glad that they were doing it. And I think in the beginning of November, they started to perform their theater show. And we were invited to the first show. And it was really, we were really happy to see the result. And it was really critical and really explained clearly how money is created by private banks out of nothing. And so it was really successful. Other shows were booked immediately in the Netherlands, so they performed for half a year, 100,000 people will come to their show. And what they experienced when they did the shows in the first month, that people were really shocked. So the audience was really shocked. Is this really how the system works? Is this, what can we do? Why is this possible? And that is why they contacted us again, and they asked us, what can we do together to collect all these people and to bring it to a higher level of discussion? So it should be a debate within society, and more people should join the debate, and also it should be on a political agenda. So then we decided to start together a citizens initiative. And what the goal of a citizens initiative is, if you have 40,000 signatures, then you can put something on a political agenda in The Hague. So if you come there with 40,000 signatures, they have to debate the topic. So we built this website, Burgerinitiatief Ons Geld. We made a formal text, so a formal proposal. And we propose that private banks should stop creating money, and that's a task of the public. So it's a task of all people. And we say, the central banks should create debt-free money. Now, almost all money is created as debt, but we need to investigate if debt-free money is possible, and we think it is possible. So we built this website, and it was ready in the 1st of January or the 2nd of January, and the Verleiders were discussing with De Wereld Draait Door, the world is turning around, the show of the world is going mad in English, to launch it officially on a Dutch television. So, and it happened 1 week ago, or 8 days ago, it happened. So they were the guests in the talk show, and the host Matthijs van Nieuwkerk, and he talked about the initiative. George Fornaus, one of the actors, really explained really nicely how the monetary system works, what are the disadvantages. That's a really power struggle to break through the power. And he launched the initiative. And the first guy who signed the initiative was Jort Kelder. He's a Dutch journalist and television presenter, and he's quite famous, and he's also quite right-wing. And quite capitalist, but he said, yeah, it's really important to investigate it, and at least we should discuss it in the parliament. And then, of course, because it was in a famous talk show, it went really viral. And immediately the website collapsed, so that was quite weird. Oh my god, the website collapsed, so everything went wrong. But apparently really a lot of people liked the initiative, so within 24 hours we had, within 28 hours we had 40,000 signatures, so we already managed. So it was really successful, so we were really glad when we showed you. Oh, is it there somewhere? Yeah, there it is. So now we have 63 or almost 64,000 signatures, so it will be discussed in Parliament. So we managed it. Oh, and I was, so for me it was really, I was really surprised that it was that successful. And also, if we see the reactions, really a lot of people send us emails, say, yeah, congratulations, really great that you... That the Dutch Parliament has to discuss the topic, and it's really one of the main injustices in this society that private banks create all the money. And so I think more and more people are aware that there's a possibility for another or a new monetary system or a really different direction. And so the aim for me with the citizen initiative is that we have a kind of a civil discussion or discussion within the society as a whole. So that people are aware how money is created nowadays and what are the alternatives. And we propose one alternative. We say it should be a public task, money creation, and we should create money debt-free. But there are more alternatives. And where I see really a similarity with the audience here or people in the Bitcoin community is that it's against the power or the power of big banks to create all the money. So that we try to break that power and to make it more equal. And that is what we do. And we work together with a lot of other groups in all different countries. So that's the International Movement for Monetary Reform and Positive Money. Does someone know Positive Money? Positive Money is a UK campaigning organization. They started this. It's the same group. So it's the same idea. So in all countries, so we have International Movement of Monetary Reform. We have in about 17 to 20 countries groups now, and we promote all the same ideas. So the debate is happening everywhere. And Positive Money started this about 4 years ago, and now it's growing. And so it's really interesting to work with all these guys all over the world together, and to study the current system and to investigate alternatives. And what I think is important, so this man in the front row said it at the end of the formal presentation, that the concept of legal tender, so in which currency should I pay my taxes, and that's really crucial to understand. And nowadays, as long as there are states, then we have to pay taxes in euros, or maybe if this go back to the gilden, then we have to pay tax in guildens. And that's a really big debate. If you promote Bitcoin ideas, then the main problem is, to me, is the tax part. So how do you organize tax? So we think that the state, if we have to pay tax in euros, the state should also create all the euros. So euros should not be created by private banks. And if there are complementary cryptocurrencies or local currencies, that's no problem. But then still, the tax system, you have to serve with euros. And then maybe some final words. So for me, the main lesson is, if you really want to put something on the agenda, I worked also together with the arts. It was really nice to work together with them. And what is their big advantage? So I give always very serious presentations with PowerPoint sheets and difficult graphs, equations. And what they are doing, they are just telling what is wrong. So it's really a power struggle. Why are private banks allowed to create money out of nothing? The interest question. So they are really to the point, and I think that's really the way to spread the message and to get it into the to in a broader discussion in society. And what I think about Bitcoin, and I think afterwards maybe we should discuss it, I think the technology behind Bitcoin is really useful and maybe even revolutionary. So you can really use it also within new monetary systems. My main question is, as said, is that the link between free currencies or not governmental currencies and the tax system. So there is a legal tender, or I don't have the solution for that question. So that's really, for me, where we should debate about. If you want other currencies, so cryptocurrencies or local currencies. And finally, it's maybe also interesting to mention that that's an idea. So one of the other board members of Foundation Our Money, Luc de Waal Malefeit, he wrote his master thesis about, is it possible to implement a Bitcoin protocol on national level? So that you say, we just implemented a Bitcoin protocol on the Dutch level, on the European level, and that's the legal tender. So then you combine cryptocurrency with legal tender, but then again there is a kind of state monopoly, and that's a bit against the Bitcoin philosophy. But that is quite interesting. At least for me it was quite interesting to read his master thesis and also to think through his ideas. So it opens a new way of thinking. So I recommend you all to go to, if you speak Dutch, to Duffel Leiders. I will show it again. They play till March 28th, all over the Netherlands, and their show will be translated into English in spring, I think, or in summer it will be ready. So go. Thank you.
Any questions?
A lot of questions. Oh my God.
Why is money creation by banks a bad thing, and why does it have to be a bad thing? Two different questions.
I think what is happening nowadays, so that all money is created as debt by private banks, is quite a big topic. So quite a big issue. And what banks do when they give a loan, on the one hand, they on their balance sheet, they place the loan, so that's debt, and on the other hand, they place a deposit those, that's money. You can spend the money. So all money that circulates, there is a debt on the other side. And the question is this really necessary? And what we propose, you can make a debt-free money supply, so that's on the central bank's balance sheets, and here you have all the accounts of all people. And you can spend this money, you never have to pay interest to the central bank. So that's one way to look at the discussion. So should all money be debt? And we argue it should not be. Then the second thing is, if we study how banks create money and how they allocate it, so especially where does the money go to, what we see, that only 10% of the loans in UK go to businesses in the real economy. And in the Netherlands, it's about 25%. So the banks create most of the money that they create for the wrong things. They create it for housing, they create it for other financial industry or financial markets, they create it for consumption. And in the end, that leads to inflation or bubbles. And if there is a crisis, like we have experienced the last 7 years or 5 years, then you see the opposite thing. So then they are not eager to hand out loans anymore. So banks themselves, they create a boom and bust cycle. And that's why we think it's bad. So they have to. It's more. It's also maybe. It's really a fundamental question: who should be allowed to create money? And the system in the past it grew like this. So okay, that's it. But now we are aware of it, and maybe we should invent something new.
So you mentioned briefly, just to respond. Yep. So here's my worry. So you mentioned two main driving factors. One is the boom and bust cycle.
Yes.
And the other one is the issue of debt, right? So we can never pay off all our debt, so we have debt-based money. Debt, greed, boom and bust cycle, you're focusing on private banks. I think the problem is, in fact, the Dutch Central Bank and not private banks. So if you have, as we had in history, a completely competitive system, a free banking system, like for instance in Scotland, I'm not sure if I'm 100% convinced by it, but
I think there's a strong argument to be made that in fact the boom and bust cycle would be much, of course there would still be a boom and bust, but it would be much less pronounced than with a central banking model. My second worry about a central banking model, and this is my really big worry, so now the central bank indirectly controls the money supply, although both of you and I would suspect that probably not very well, particularly when it contracts. Here's my worry. Once you directly give the central bank control again over the money, it also becomes very quickly a political eye point of politicians to again take control of the central bank. And I'm very worried that a central bank is actually going to be able to maintain the degree of independence that they currently have if you give it control over money again. Hence Bitcoin. No, anyway.
Try to answer the last worry quickly. So what the main idea of monetary reform is to split the decision how much money should be created and the allocation of the money. And so the monetary committee or a central bank or a fourth authority within the state should only decide how much new money should be created. Then there are rules and all kind of protocols you can use how they should make that kind of decision. And then, so they decide in Europe we need 20 billion more euros. Then they hand it over to politicians. And the politicians, or it's a political question how we spend the money. And there are different opportunities. Politicians can spend it just in the economy, can lower taxes, or they just hand out it to all the citizens. And for me, the last option sounds the most equal. So like now, today there was also in the Dutch newspaper, the Volkskrant, someone arguing that this is really the best thing also now to do. Just hand over money to all citizens. It's really good for inequality, so that just the normal people in the streets get more money and can spend. Don't spend it on financial markets. And so there are different ways to solve that issue. So, and we see what we see also nowadays, it is already happening. So partly the proposal is already happening. And that makes it really weird. So the central bank, we'll do it from, I think this week on.
You mean quantitative easing?
Yeah, quantitative easing. So they just create money, but they spend it again on financial markets and not in the real economy. So that's again the same problem. It's exactly the same what the commercial banks do.
Just a last one. My worry is most of the inventions having to do with money in history have to do with governments being able to fight wars. And if you give more direct control of politicians to how money is created and spent, I'm very worried that it's going to be misused rather than used in the egalitarian way that you imagine.
Yeah, we should. We can discuss the detail later.
Exactly.
Yeah, thank you. Good points.
You only want to change it for the Netherlands or for Europe?
So that's also in the UK. The debate is much more easy because there you can just say, we just wanted to change for the UK. And in Europe, you have immediately this kind of problem. And so we work together with quite some other groups in other European countries. And I think, how it's organized nowadays, it's always the. It's not ideal, so we have to find a way. So I think for Europe is the best way to solve the issue. But for us, so we focus in first, the citizen initiative is focused on the Netherlands, so we want to put it on a political agenda in the Netherlands, and the next step could be to go to Europe, Brussels. I think that if it crashes, then there are all kinds of ideas, like bitcoins, but also monetary reform proposals, and then the ideas are really worked out. That was really happening after the crash in 2007-8. No one knew what to do. So all people, there were all, the only idea was, just continue the same way. And now you have plenty of ideas for new monetary reform, and that's really interesting. So if the euro crashes, then immediately there will people start to build a new system. I'm quite sure about it. Yeah.
Can you please argue again why you think the government should be in charge of it?
Yeah, so the question is, so we have to pay tax.
Why?
But if you look at reality, 50% of the GDP goes through the tax system.
The first question should be, why should we pay taxes?
But then you don't look at reality. Yeah, so if 50, as long as 50% of all Dutch money goes to the tax system, then you can say, okay, yeah, why do we should, that's a really interesting philosophical question. But if you want to do a proposal that fits the current system, you can't have that kind of argument. That's really denying reality.
It's just like a proposal that fits to the current system.
So, but if you have a collapse of the system, then you have really the freedom. If it's a real collapse, like there is a world war or there is a really crash, and you don't save all the banks, then you have to. Then is the moment to maybe build a real new system. But this is with monetary reform. It's also that's why the reform. So it's a reform of the current system, and that's of course it's a very good debate. But how do you let explode the system and that all people are aware that the world without tax is possible, and maybe then you get tax even on a more local scale, but it are still taxes. And I think that there are quite some things in common in society, so that's why you pay tax, and there's also nothing wrong with. So I'm not against tax, but more how tax is used maybe. But
On this topic,
yeah.
A lot of these discussions, they always start asking what really important people are supporting the initiative.
Yeah.
Like, for example, professors in monetary economics and what have you. Now, on this topic, what sort of people on this top level, sort of Champions League level, have you sort of within your organization?
Yeah, that's
who are supporting. To be honest with you, I've been involved in politics when I was young. Even encourage Maxime Verhagen to become active in politics.
Yep.
So, I mean, you'll be hammered if you don't get quality people.
Yep.
Now, to answer this question, a name popped up in my mind. When the euro was debated in Dutch parliament, in actual fact, it was only about one person of the political parties who was against the euro. This was a Professor De Haan. Professor De Haan was also a guy from Hoogleraar Macroeconomics.
Yep.
And in later television programs, they went back in time on the whole banking crisis and the euro crisis, and they interviewed him yet again on his line of reasoning. But he was hammered by the